won the debate tonight.
Pulgama mein jo veer shaheed hue un veer shaheedon ke naam aapka vote samarpit ho sakta hai kya?
The Prime Minister and Amit Shah's speech under the Supreme Court's radar. The Congress party has moved the top court, alleging a violation in the model code of conduct.
Why is this thing happening that just when it comes to the Prime Minister and the President of the Bharatiya Janata Party, that you're completely silent and you're inactive? It's something that's clearly discriminatory.
The Supreme Court has now issued a notice to the Election Commission. Meanwhile, the Election Commission also got into a huddle to decide its course of action against the alleged violations of the MCC by both Amit Shah as well as the Prime Minister.
The Congress had filed about 8 complaints before the Election Commission, trying to highlight the purported poll code violations in speeches of Prime Minister Modi and Amit Shah. The Election Commission thus far had remained silent. Today, when the Supreme Court was seized of the matter, the Election Commission informed the top court as to how it is now considering these complaints.
As Congress cries foul over the Prime Minister and Amit Shah's speech, invoking the armed forces in their campaign rallies, Mirror now asks, is the Election Commission dragging its feet? Should the Election Commission have acted earlier? Is the EC being an impartial watchdog? Let's debate.
Well, our focus is the Election Commission this evening, but there's breaking news coming in. The Election Commission has once again put a 48-hour campaigning ban on Samajwadi Party's Azam Khan. This is the second time he is being banned from campaigning in this election for giving highly provocative speeches. Earlier, he was restrained from campaigning for 72 hours for his comments against actor-turned-politician Jaya Prada, but this is the second censure being issued on to Azam Khan. One would note also that while he was banned from campaigning, his son was campaigning on his behalf and he also made some fairly unsavory remarks. My colleague Meenakshi on the phone line with me, who will give us some information on the second ban. Meenakshi, Azam Khan being banned for a second time?
Well, that's right, Faye. This is the Election Commission really speaking its mind forcefully now. Of course, this is all happening because we know that the Election Commission can also be complained against before the Supreme Court, as you saw in the Mahua Moitra case. But news coming in about how the Election Commission has taken complete umbrage to the fact of repeated provocative speeches being made by Azam Khan, and therefore this second ruling also coming in prohibiting Azam Khan from campaigning. Incidentally, big breaking news also coming in as we speak, where the Election Commission has given Prime Minister Narendra Modi a clean chit pertaining to his first April Wardha speech.
Yes, in fact, Meenakshi, forgive me, I'll just read this out to our audience and we put it up on the screen. Stay with us though so you can explain this to us a little more. The Election Commission has now given a clean chit to Prime Minister Modi for the Wardha speech, I beg your pardon, on the 1st of April. The EC says the matter has been examined in great detail and in accordance with the provisions of the Model Code of Conduct and the RP Act, or the Representations of People's Act, the Maharashtra CEOs or the Chief Election Officer's report says no violation has been noticed. Just to tell our viewers, Meenakshi, that the comment that was made at the time by the Prime Minister in that speech was, how can the Congress be forgiven for insulting the Hindus in front of the world? Weren't you hurt when you heard the word Hindu terror? How can a community known for peace, brotherhood and harmony be linked to terrorism? It's evidence from the fact that one has to contest a seat where the minority is the majority. Meenakshi, it's that comment that the EC has now decided on, was not in violation. Could you take us through right now how many comments are in front of the EC or being considered by the EC at this point? How many complaints?
Yes, Faye, absolutely. Interesting question that. There are a sum total of 3 complaints that the Election Commission, from what we have gathered from our sources, will be mulling over. And this particular speech of the Prime Minister, dated 1st of April from Wardha in Maharashtra, now has been cleared by the Election Commission, which says, like you rightly mentioned, that it is not violative of the NCC. It is not violative of the RCS. And the Maharashtra CEO's report has also been relied upon by the Election Commission. Now, very interestingly, some quick perspective for our viewers today. This is the decision of the Election Commission, which can again be a subject matter of a fresh challenge before the apex court, which is incidentally what the Congress Party wanted. The Congress Party wanted for the Election Commission to decide the issue one way or the other, not keep a prolonged, continued silence on whether or not it is taking stock of the complaints or deciding the complaints one way. So now, since the Election Commission has spoken its mind, and if this finding of the Election Commission is something which the Congress finds completely unpalatable and completely unacceptable, then they will always have the option of challenging it before the top court of this country again. So that is why today's developments that have played out in the EC and parallelly in the Supreme Court, which you will be debating in a short while, assumes so much import.
Meenakshi, last question, quick question there. Of course, the EC has now, as we can see, ruled on this matter, and they have asked for responses in other matters, and they've asked for transcripts of speeches in the 6th April, speech. Does this, is the Congress's allegation that the EC is not doing anything in that case? What is that allegation based on? What have the petitioners in this case gone to the Supreme Court about?
Well, yes, Faye, they have submitted a lot of details to the Election Commission. They have submitted a sum total of about 8 complaints to the Election Commission beginning the 1st of April. And the Congress's main grievance is very simple. It says that election process is a time-bound process. And therefore, to have a quasi-judicial body like the Election Commission to accept the complaints and not adjudicate or decide the complaints either which way is something which is completely a travesty. It takes away from the essence of the electoral process. And like we have been making this particular news of Election Commission clean chit to the Prime Minister pertaining to his speech dated the 1st of April in Wardha, there are 2 other complaints pertaining to the Prime Minister that Election Commission has to opine on.
Yes,
so for
okay.
The Congress, yes, back to you.
All right, okay, Meenakshi, my colleague Meenakshi there, who is bringing us that information that the Election Commission has decided in 2 cases. In 1 case, where it comes to the speech made by the Prime Minister on the 1st of April, it has decided that speech is not in any violation of the Model Code of Conduct. In the 2nd case, they've decided that Azam Khan happens to be in violation a 2nd time, and he has been banned from contesting again for another 72 hours. And here's the question that we're asking this evening. Has the Election Commission been dragging its feet in specific cases? This is the allegation that the Congress has made before the Supreme Court, that the Election Commission has not been entirely impartial and has not created a level playing field and has actually been hesitant when it came to matters regarding the Prime Minister and BJP President Amit Shah. Is that true? What is the stand right now of the Congress now that the Election Commission has in fact made these 2 decisions? On the show with me, Vivek Reddy for the BJP, Aman Pawar for the Congress, Ms. Neerja Chaudhary, very senior journalist, Sangeet Kumar Ragi, political analyst, Professor Jagdeep Chokar, founder of ADR. And ADR has also gone to court asking for action from the Election Commission on a different case. Amit Kimka is an advocate with the Delhi High Court. I welcome all of you to this conversation. Thank you for joining us. Ms. Chaudhary, good evening. My first question is to you. Do you believe, given that all of the various things that have come into play over the last month, that the EC might be hesitant when it comes to complaints about the Prime Minister or about Amit Shah? Is there substance to that allegation?
Look, whether or not there's substance, but the perception is that and is increasingly becoming that. Now the EC has taken note of this one case that April 1, where the Prime Minister asked people to vote in the memory of the Jawans who had died, the Balakot, the Balakot, the Pulwama Jawans. And the Congress has taken umbrage at that and has complained, and the EC has said no. The explanation being given is that the Prime Minister did not ask anybody to vote in favor of a particular party. Now that's a kind of a technical thing. You know, in all the complaints that are coming this time, and many more are coming in this election, I feel the time may have come to actually specify more clearly what constitutes a violation of the model code of conduct. You know, there's been a convention, there a lot of things are understood. People don't, you know, cross the Lakshman Rekha. It's based on the evolution of those conventions. But I think with our politics having become so contentious, and I would say even, you know, frequent name-calling that's taking place, I think the time may have come to spell this out more clearly and for, you know, for a national discussion also to precede the EC taking that view.
Well, very well said, in fact, that, this is the impression that is being created at this point. I want to take the question also to Professor Choker, the founding member of ADR. Professor, do you believe that the EC is not being completely impartial? Do you think there's a difference in the manner in which the EC is treating different candidates?
Well, one of the arguments given in favor of not making the model code of conduct a legally enforceable code has been that under the current dispensation, it is possible to take action quickly. And the election process, when the election process is on, then quick decisions are required. I remember Dr. Qureshi talking about this very, very often. Now, if it is going to take 30 days to take a decision, then I don't think the model code of conduct is serving any purpose. The decisions are required, and they are usually, in the past and even now, decisions have been taken quickly. But it seems, and I think Nirja is absolutely right, there's a perception that in some cases, there is inordinate amount of time being taken to, you know, calling for transcripts of speeches. All this in the past has been done in a couple of days. But 30 days or 26 days, etc., is certainly a cause of serious concern.
Cause for serious concern. Vivek Reddy, what is your response to that? And let me just point out that it is true that the decision or the speech that was made on the 1st of April, we're getting a decision today on the 30th. It has taken a month. Is the EC dragging its feet on specific cases, Mr. Reddy?
Well, I think the BJP also had given a complaint that Rahul Gandhi was saying chowkidar chor hai, and there is no answer on this issue by the EC. Normally, the procedure adopted by the EC, Faye, is it entertains the complaint and sits on it and takes a decision one way or the other. But many a time when it decides not to take a decision, which is unlike in this case, it does not intimate that it has not taken a decision. But when it decides to take a decision, it passes an order. Now, here is a case when Rahul Gandhi has been going about with several lies that chowkidar is chor hai. Complaints are lodged, but the EC has done nothing. So how can we say it is selective with respect to Prime Minister only and not selective with respect to Rahul Gandhi? So the EC has been consistent in its reactions to complaints which are generally made by against these political heads. This is one. The second thing is, on the merits of the complaint also, there is something as what is called as a political debate, which is permissible and which encompasses a large area, but which should not get into the area of army. That political debate is that you need to say that and reach to the people that look here, here is a government which took strong action. And that is up for debate in a democracy. I think, Faye, in a democracy, all these issues must reach the people. People must be able to debate it. Political leaders must talk about it. But there is one thing in the model code of conduct which says one cannot make unsubstantiated allegations. And what Rahul Gandhi is making today, chowkidar chor hai, is an allegation without substance, without evidence, without any credentials. And if that is so, why didn't the Election Commission take action? So these are the issues where Election Commission, we cannot say that it is impartial, but the Election Commission, in its wisdom, has now arrived at a decision that there is no poll code violation, and it is right, because you are not appealing to vote a particular party on the basis of any of the references made by Mr. Narendra Modi. All that Mr. Modi is saying is...
Mr. Vivek Reddy, Mr. Vivek Reddy, let's go piece by piece. Okay, I heard you out. I heard you out. I heard you out.
And that is up for debate.
Okay, let's go piece by piece. 9th April 2019.
In an enlightened democracy.
9th April 2019, the Prime Minister speaking in Lathur in Maharashtra. I want to ask all first-time voters that your first vote be dedicated to the soldiers who conducted the Balakot airstrikes. Your first vote should be in the name of the martyrs who lost their lives in Pulwama. Eliminating terrorists from their homes, and then he said vote for the BJP. What part of this is a suggestion that this is a government that takes action? Isn't this a clear indicator of asking for votes in the name of the army? Literally asking for votes in the name of the army.
Look here, Faye. Look here, Faye.
Yes.
When an incident such as Pulwama has affected this nation and it has made a deep impact on this nation, it is expected that political leaders talk about it on the political side and ask people to vote on the basis of their discretion, on the basis of their wisdom, and to consider how this event will have a larger impact on the destiny of the nation. What is wrong? I mean, that is what an enlightened democracy is all about. Every reference to the army cannot be on the wrong side of the model code of
conduct.
Let
me read this out
to you
one more time.
Here the Prime Minister makes a healthy remark.
How is this a healthy remark?
A time has come for this nation to dedicate its vote.
No. Dedicate your vote to Pulwama, vote for the BJP. How is this a healthy remark? What part of that is healthy according to you?
Not to Pulwama.
That's what he says.
Zero tolerance.
No. I'm quoting
here. Now taken a policy about.
I want first-time voters to dedicate your vote to the soldiers who conducted the Balakot airstrikes. Dedicate your vote in the name of the martyrs who lost their lives in Pulwama. What part of this is healthy, tell me?
No, what is wrong in talking about it? Doesn't mean that the leader of the nation should not even refer about it. This has had a deep impact on the destiny of this nation. What is wrong in talking about demonetization, which has had a deep impact on the destiny of the nation?
Mr. Reddy, nobody is talking about demonetization. I would like for someone to talk about demonetization, but demonetization is not getting mentioned anymore. Amit Khemka, you've had a moment to look at the model code of conduct. Could you tell us?
Every reference to the army, Faye, cannot be on the wrong side of the model code of conduct. There can be a healthy debate about what this government did
Amit
and
Khemka
about
will
what
respond.
The previous government did not do.
Okay, Amit
there
Khemka.
Can be a healthy debate. And
Mr. Reddy, please.
Encourage
Amit them. Khemka, go ahead.
Yes.
Faye, to be precise, to my mind, army of this nation or our martyrs are our national pride and our national symbols, just like a Tiranga or just like a Rashtriya Gaan. And it is a corrupt practice under Section 123 to ask for vote in the name of national symbols. So if you say that army is not a national symbol, it's up to you. But if our martyrs are national symbols as much as my Tiranga, then I feel that it is a corrupt practice to not only it is a breach of the model code of conduct. Model code of conduct, of course, has two parts. One is which cannot be a ground for cancellation of election.
Yes.
The other are those provisions which can become the ground for cancellation of elections later on. Now, it is the politicians very carefully in past used to only breach those portions of model code of conduct which could not become the ground for setting aside the elections. But now, in this election which we see the discourse has gone so low where they are not afraid of even committing those acts which are clearly covered under Section 123 of Representation of People's Act and would amount to corrupt practices. There is clearly, from the stage you are saying, you are intimidating the voters by saying that if your area or if your polling booth does not vote in my favor, I am going to note it down. Now, it is intimidation, and it is clearly a corrupt practice under Section 123. Now, the only problem is that none of the parties, Faye, I say, is ready to go for election reforms.
Yes.
About which Mr. Khokar is fighting tooth. I mean, he's day in and day out. So
yes.
The problem is that when you don't go for those election reforms, none of the parties is ready to do that.
Yes, fair point. Mr. Kimkar, let me just bring in the other members of the panel as well. Yes, Sangeet Kumar Raghi joins us. He's a political analyst. Mr. Raghi, do you believe that the Election Commission has been dragging its feet? And I just want to point out that Mr. Reddy in the beginning agreed that we've been complaining to the Election Commission about Rahul Gandhi and they haven't done anything about it. So maybe they're not being partial. Maybe they're just being slow.
Look, two of the panelists said that the perception is like that the EC is dragging its feet when it comes to taking decision on the campaigns against the Prime Minister.
Yes.
And Amit Shah. But always remember that the perception is opinionated statement. It is not based on the fact.
Okay.
Perception is a normative judgment. It is a subjective judgment. So it has no base at all.
No base
so
at all.
No base at all. You ask 10 people, 10 people have 10 perceptions.
Mm.
So with due regard to Mr. Shokar, this is completely a biased statement that the perception is. Does Mr. Shokar has any statistical figure in the mind? Does Mr. Shokar has any kind of statistical survey that the EC has been rated by the people of this country this manner? Quite pretty sitting in the air-conditioned chamber and making this kind of a statement is something which is biased
right.
So, itself.
Mr. Raghi, the Supreme Court has pulled up the EC on various counts. Please allow me. You can't just dismiss. What facts do you have to dismiss, Professor Shokar?
Can I continue?
If you are going to base your arguments on facts, yes.
Do you have any statistical facts on this? No, that is why I am asking, Faye, do you have any statistical position in front of you?
Yes, I do, in fact.
Just because a journalist says so.
The professor is not good enough, the journalist is not good enough, the Supreme Court is not good enough. Whose facts will you accept?
I'll read out the facts.
9th March, EC issues a circular. You ask me for facts. Now you have to have the stomach to listen to them. 9th March, EC issues a circular. Political parties banned from using army and therefore their political propaganda. 10th March, EC notifies the dates of the election. 19th March, second circular prohibiting political parties from using army in their speeches. 30th March, EC serves notices to Ministry of Railway and Civil Aviation for printing Maybe Chokidar on cups. 1st April, the Prime Minister makes a statement at Vadra, which has now, the EC has decided is fine. 5th April, the Congress Party files a complaint on the Vadra speech. 5th April again, EC issues a third circular preventing politicians and candidates from using the army. 6th April, EC seeks a transcribe of the Prime Minister's speech. 6th April, Prime Minister speaking in Nanded goes on again to mention the army. 8th April, 66 retired bureaucrats write to the president. 9th April, while speaking in Nagpur, Amit Shah mentions terrorists and the Air Force. Should I go on? I can go right up till yesterday. You wanted facts and statistics? I can call it all out.
What are your facts and statistics? Because you don't have courage to listen to. Because you are the anchor, so you have right to continue for day long. But you are... First of all, you listen to first. You have at least the courage to listen to others.
So speak when listening. What is your argument?
Then you listen to others. Yeah, you are not listening. There can be motivated people who can make such kind of statements. Is it not true that those who complains are not motivated? What is the guarantee that they are not motivated? I am just making the argument for sake of arguments.
I can see you making an argument.
10 people sitting, 10 journalists sitting, and if they... if 10 journalists make this kind of a statement, does mean that it's true? There are institutional arrangement for that purpose, and the institution has taken call. Institution went through, and what the institution did today, that it has
after
examined
the
in detail.
Court pulled it up twice.
And whatever the, you know, allegation. Can you allow me to speak?
If you are going to speak on national television, you have to rely on facts. You have not given me a single fact. Do you realize that the Supreme Court has had to pull up the Election Commission at repeated counts? And it's only when the Supreme Court pulled up the Election Commission did the Election Commission release any sort of censure.
I am not a biased like you who doesn't have the courage to listen to the others. I am making arguments.
I can see that, but your arguments are biased from core.
And that is why, you are not ready to listen to. You call five people, anti-BJP people on your channel, and then you keep going on hammering the BJP. That also shows that you are completely biased. You are not objective in your statement and
also putting
questions.
Do you have anything to say about the topic we are discussing?
Why are you not allowing me to answer?
Do you have anything at all to say about the topic we are discussing?
That is what I said, that it is, there are institutional arrangement for the for this purpose. Those who are coming on the channel and think that the perception is there, they should come forward. That what is the basis? Only because they think so? Only because a journalist thinks so? Only because way institutions think so? That is why the institution is dragging the feet? I would be saying that no, institution is doing fairly a right job.
Okay.
You task 10 people. That is why in the beginning I said that it's a normative judgment. It is a subjective judgment.
Okay. All right. Let me take this back to Neerja Chaudhary. Neerja Chaudhary, I want to remind our viewers, is a very, very senior journalist. Ms. Chaudhary, I know you've heard what Sangeet Kumar Raghi has just said. And to recap, he said the complaints are all motivated. And those of us on the panel right now who are anti-BJP, who have said that it seems like the Election Commission are dragging their feet, are just doing it because it seems like that to us. We don't have the facts. These institutional arrangements are made for this sort of thing. Do you want to respond to him, Ms. Chaudhary?
I think, you know, it would be less than fair. Let's not get into who's anti-BJP, who's pro-BJP. You can say others that were raising questions are anti-BJP. I can say you are pro-BJP. Let's not get into that at all. There's no end to that argument. Let's look at, as you were saying, Faye, let's look at the hard facts. Why is a perception being created? Because it's taken the Election Commission one whole month to respond. And as has been said by other speakers, the EC, when an election process is on, the whole value of the EC's response to any complaint is speed with which it comes out with what it has to say. Now, that's not happened. And if you take a whole month, you know, the whole thing becomes really redundant. So that is what has created, you know, if the EC says, I've gone into the whole thing, I think there's nothing in it. Fair enough. It's the EC that's empowered to say that. But the EC has had to be prodded by the Supreme Court of India that they're not taking action. And it's only when the criticism has come that the EC, for instance, issued notices to Yogi Adityanath, to Azam Khan, to Meneka Gandhi, and so on. Till then, it was quiet. So that is why, you know, we've seen for the last 30 years, election commissioners sit in that seat, and actually, they're all appointees of the government of India. But as I keep saying, once they sit in that seat, they get the 56-inch ki chhati to ensure that elections in India are fair and free, because the whole world is watching this largest democracy on earth, how we conduct our elections, and we are very proud of it.
Yes.
So when things begin to be questioned, when you worry about things going wrong, you will raise questions. If I don't raise questions, what am I sitting here? I might as well be running a dukan somewhere. It's my job to raise questions.
Very well said. Professor Chokar, and I do know that Aman Pawar of the Congress has a question. As soon as Professor Chokar has spoken, I will come back to you, Aman Pawar. Professor Chokar, do you want to respond to what Sangeet Kumar Raghi said, that these are just feelings and impressions, but they are not backed with facts?
I want to respond to that and also three things that were said before that. Okay. The first was that there has been a complaint against a Congress leader which has not been responded to. Mm. I would say that is also wrong.
Yes.
That's because Election Commission has been slow in responding to complaints against one party does not mean it is justified in responding against complaints to another party. It should respond to all parties.
Yes.
Number two, it was said that sometimes the Election Commission takes action, sometimes it keeps quiet. This keeping quiet is the problem. There is this dictum that one should all, justice should not only be done, it should be seen to be done. If the Election Commission has some doubt or it has it is not convinced of it, it should come right out and say there is nothing in this complaint. It is when it does not say anything that the perception gets created, which my fellow panelists were very upset about. Keeping quiet gives rise to suspicion and perception. Thirdly, leader of, anyway, I can't see what I wrote. In terms of perception being created, you know, perceptions are not always completely unrelated to facts. There are facts which are interpreted by different people differently. I interpret a 1 month or a 20-day delay in response by the EC, whether to a complaint against the BJP or to a complaint against the Congress or to a complaint against the BSP, I think all of that is wrong.
Yes, I agree with you.
EC should have responded at the most within 3, 4, 5 days.
I agree with you. And I want to take this question to Aman Pawar of the Congress party, if I may.
For my perception. Yes. No, but let me just add one more point.
Okay.
It was said that these are motivated comments made from air-conditioned places. Hmm. I want to put it on record. I am not sitting in an air-conditioned room.
Okay, in fact, absolutely. Let me just bring in Aman Pawar. Aman Pawar of the Congress, it was the 17th of April when the Election Commission took note of Rahul Gandhi's Chaukidar Chor Hai comment. No decision has been made on that comment up till now. Today is the 30th of April. So, are you really warranted in saying the EC is going easy on the Prime Minister? They're going easy on you also. The EC is going easy. That should be your argument.
Let me be upfront. Whether it is Rahul Gandhi or anybody else, the Election Commission cannot use anybody as a cover to protect the Prime Minister and Mr. Amit Shah. And as a responsible spokesperson of the party, I must say that the Election Commission should take action against anyone and everyone. Now, here are the facts. We have filed 8 complaints, 8 poll code violations against Mr. Modi and Amit Shah, and it has been over a month that the Election Commission did not act, and today they gave them a clean chit. Now, what Mr. Modi is doing in this while is that in his desperation to shift focus from real issues, be it job, be it the demonetization blunder, be it the mess of GST, be it the slumping value of rupee against dollars, they don't talk about any of these. He's been regularly conducting poll code violations to divert attention from real issues, and the Election Commission is not doing anything. And this allows him to shift focus from the real issues in India's elections which are happening today. So this is what we are saying, that be it anyone, take action against Rahul Gandhi, take action,
so let me ask you this, Mr. Pawar.
How is the Prime Minister indemnified? Which law protects the Prime Minister?
Mr. Pawar, let me ask you this. You're absolutely right,
Ms.
and I completely agree with you.
Can I come in, please?
1 second. I completely agree with you that the Election Commission should act immediately, because during an election, our entire democracy is in the hands of the Election Commission. But I want to also understand from you, the Congress party is being taking the Model Code of Conduct very personally and complaining every time there is a slight toe out of place as far as the MCC is concerned. What did Rahul Gandhi mean when he said that the Supreme Court has said Chaukidar Chor Hai? Isn't that baseless, in violation of the code and in contempt of Supreme Court? Isn't the Congress just as guilty of treating the MCC with disregard in this election?
Not at all. See, here are the facts. One, this deal, the Rafael scam deal, wherein Mr. Modi favoured his close aide, Mr. Anil Ambani, and gave him a 30,000 rupee crore contract, taking it away from HAL. What is the justification?
No. Answer the question of the MCC.
To know that. The other is a company. I'm coming to that. Even in the Supreme Court, Rahul Gandhi has very categorically said that I stand by my comments that Chaukidar chore hai.
But he attributed it to the Supreme Court, Mr. Pawar.
And today I'm saying this now.
He attributed it to the Supreme Court.
Please, Faye. How can a company which was formed only 12 days
where
earlier,
is the evidence?
12 days
you can't
back,
make
be given a contract to a 70-year-old company which is HAL? Why can't...
Mr. Pawar, you seem to have misunderstood my question or the conversation that we're having.
Mr. Modi could never prove.
No, one second. I'm not having a conversation about Rafael. We will have one as soon as the Supreme Court has a hearing date. But that Supreme Court hearing date has been moved. Mr. Pawar, my question is this. The Supreme Court never said Chaukidar Chor hai. Rahul Gandhi attributed that statement to the Supreme Court.
Yes.
And that is a violation of the court, is it not?
With humility, Rahul Gandhi has apologized to the Supreme Court for the limited purpose that he attributed the statement to the Supreme Court. We still stand by the fact that how can a 526 crore rupee plane is being purchased in 1600 crore rupees by the Modi government.
Okay,
so these are the facts, these are the questions that the people of this country are asking.
All right, I just want to take this back to Neerja Chaudhary and in response, just one second, in response to the argument that these statements are being made in AC rooms, in response to the argument that these comments are being made in AC rooms, let me point out to you, Neerja Chaudhary is a very senior journalist, and I know for a fact that in the sweltering summer, she was in Uttar Pradesh and she travelled on a two-wheeler into the heart of Varanasi because she needed or she wanted to be there. She insisted on being on the front row to witness the Prime Minister's rally, and it was not easy because that rally was very, very crowded. And she went there and she did her job. So anyone who sits around and says AC rooms, people don't know what they're talking about, really need to do their homework. Ms. Chaudhary, you want to respond to, none of the politicians will take this seriously, but what is the risk of an election commission that is not doing its job?
It's the strength of our institutions that maintains our democracy. And there are many flaws in our democracy, but the heartbeat of our democracy is fair elections. And the Election Commission is mandated to conduct free and fair elections. That is why I say, the election commissioners have taken their job. I'm not saying this election commissioner is not doing it, not at all. I'm only raising questions that why is so much time being taken?
Yes.
Election commissions have made the country proud over the last three decades. Let's be very honest on that one. And, we have faulted A, B, C, D here and there, but by and large, that is the story. And I would also say, I go back to my first point, maybe the time has come to very clearly spell out what constitutes a violation of the Model Code of Conduct. Whether just a mere allegation does it, or a dumbing down of the debate, which we are seeing now, emotive issues taking precedence over the bread and butter substantive issues, that is not necessarily a model violation of a Model Code of Conduct. So, divisive things, yes, those are, or the kind of things that Azam Khan said about Jaya Prada. Mm. That's a clear violation. You talk about the color of a woman's underwear.
Yes.
And what could be worse than that in a democratic or electoral discourse? So I think a time has come when we need to look at this very clear, carefully, and the Election Commission also maybe needs to redefine this for the country.
Well, I also, Neeraji, want to ask you about, and you did say, Election Commission needs to redefine it, but when it comes to mentioning the army, And Vivek Reddy made an argument where he said basically that the Prime Minister wants to refer to the work that is done and it can't all be on the wrong side. Now, I read out one comment which is asking first-time voters to pledge their votes. The second comment is 21st April in Pathan, where the Prime Minister said, when Abhinandan was captured by Pakistan, I said to Pakistan, if anything happens to our pilot, we will not leave you. A senior American official called up Pakistan and said, Modi has kept 12 missiles and he might attack you at any situation. Pakistan announced they would return our pilot, else it would have been Qatal ki Raat, or a night of slaughter. Now, is this a grey area? Is this a violation of the code? Is this what has flummoxed the Election Commission for the last 20 days?
You know, I would say, yes, Qatal ki Raat made you uncomfortable and you wonder, I wondered whether it would constitute. Mm. Also, you know, our nukes being, are not Diwali crackers, made me very uncomfortable.
Yes.
But for the Prime Minister, legitimate to say, even as a leader, you know, that this is what we have done. We responded in time. And one of the reasons why people are looking at Narendra Modi today and thinking of giving him a second term is because he had the courage and he had the ability to take the risks to go into what they say, the Pakistan's territory and strike there. We can quibble about what happened there. But certainly ordinary people are looking at, that's one of the reasons why they're looking at him. So far, so good, nothing wrong. But to ask for votes in the for his party alone in the name of the armed forces, that I think is the politicization of the armed forces. And the EC and Supreme Court have both talked about this.
In fact, let me read out another statement.
The message would have gone even without the Prime Minister saying vote for the BJP on this.
Yes. Mr. Reddy, I know you want to respond, but before that, let me read out one more comment. 22nd April, Amit Shah in Krishnanagar. 44 of our jawans were martyred in Pulwama. Earlier, nothing used to happen after such incidents. But Narendra Modi ordered his Air Force on the 13th day to take our aircrafts and blow the terrorists to pieces in Pakistan. Again, a reference to whose Air Force it really is. Isn't that in violation of the code, Vivek Reddy?
Well, I think, one thing that he refers to, that earlier nothing was done. I think it is part of the political debate and it should be. Otherwise, there is no purpose in a democracy. Ultimately, what is a democracy? You have to bring in all issues, whether it is bread and butter, whether it is security, it all affects us and our future. So it is moot and central to the election and the destiny of the nation that these issues are brought. And when he refers to, we can't refer to the model code of conduct as a system of fossilized rules. Fossilized meaning that cut and dry it will apply like this, cut and dry it will apply like this. What was the broader theme on which Mr. Amit Shah was talking about, Faye? He was saying, look here, the earlier government did not do anything. And Modi ordered,
Mr. Reddy, the model code of conduct has to be cut and dry.
Takes a decision.
The model code of conduct has to be cut and dry. It has to be watertight. It can't be subjective at all.
You have to look at the broader spirit of the discussion.
No.
Right. You have to look at the broader spirit
of the discussion. In fact, it's the exact opposite of the broader spirit of the discussion.
The broader spirit of the discussion is the earlier government did nothing.
Is it wrong to say that? Fine, Mr. Reddy.
Of course, it is a fact.
Okay, the earlier government did nothing, whether or not you want to make that statement. I think that's been conceded by the panel. But I'm focusing on what you said about the model code of conduct. One second. The model code of conduct, and I'll give Amit Khemka an opportunity. One second.
For Vivek Reddy's information, let me tell him, in 1971, the earlier government under Indira Gandhi had cut Pakistan's neck and divided it into Bangladesh. In 1975, Indira Gandhi gave nuclear weapons to India, but we never demanded votes in these names. Let him know all this.
This is precisely.
Now, also, Mr. Modi has been seeking votes in the name of those who were martyred in Pulwama.
Why don't you go 100 years ago, when the Congress party was formed, and what you did for the freedom of the country? These are not issues that are moot here.
For the last 10 days, he could not control it. And that led to the death of
Mr. All right, gentlemen, let's stop. Okay, Mr. Pawar, I understand your argument. Just one second. Just stop yelling at each other. This is not that kind of show. To the politicians, I want to stay on point of the Election Commission and the Model Code of Conduct. I don't want to discuss the history of the country, yes, but I must point out, Vivek Reddy, for a party that answers most questions with the last 70 years of the Congress, for you to turn around and say you don't want to discuss the history of the Congress party actually is quite amusing. One second. Mr. Amit Khemka, the statement made by Vivek Reddy that the Model Code of Conduct needn't be watertight, it has to be, you know, sort of looked at from a larger point of conversation. How would that work?
Faye, let me for a moment agree with Mr. Reddy. And let me remind him that the Model Code of Conduct in Hindi is Adarsh Achar Sanghita. There is a word Adarsh attached to it. It could have been simply called Achar Sanghita. So the conduct of the politicians is expected to be exemplary. That is the spirit which he is talking about of the Adarsh Achar Sanghita, that their conduct has to be exemplary. Now, we just now, a minute ago, saw what is this conduct of the politicians. Is it exemplary? Is it exemplary to say that you are worse than me? Oh, okay, I am bad, but you are worse. Is it exemplary? Is it, what are they supposed to be doing? What are they supposed to be, how should be their conduct to the public?
The conduct should be exemplary.
That is the crux. That is the spirit of... Yes.
Why is the BJP not discussing issues?
That is what I am talking of.
What have they done in the last 5 years?
No, no, don't interrupt.
Please behave.
The BJP has been discussing issues. It is the Congress...
Why are they not raising unnecessary issues?
Okay, all right.
Don't show your conduct. Your conduct... Please let me, sir, please. What I am trying to say is that what is expected out of these politicians is that your conduct while going for an election should be above normal. It should be better than the normal. It should be exemplary, so to say. It should be Adarsh. You must be setting up the Adarsh.
All right.
That is the spirit of Model Code of Conduct.
Professor,
and that is what...
Yes. Professor Choker, here's the question.
Faye, it doesn't mean that
your
you should not talk about vital issues in the nation. Including employment.
No. Mr. Reddy, nobody is saying you shouldn't talk at all.
Yes.
But you have to follow the rules.
Yes.
The rules are not subject to interpretation.
We need not be oversensitive about this.
Okay.
It is not subject to interpretation, but you must look at it from the context that it is said.
No.
The words take the color from the context. You can't divorce yourself from context.
One second.
Trying to say that you take a single sentence and build your Model Code of Conduct violation, Mr. Khemka?
Now he wants to
the Adarsh Niti is there not to say take a single word out of context.
Now you want to be literal.
You have to take it from the
now
broader
context. Now your spirit
context.
Has gone.
You have to allow parties to debate on issues.
No. One second.
That is how an enlightened democracy works. No.
All right. Mr. Reddy, one second. Let me bring in Mr. Professor Choker on this. Professor Choker, my fear is this. Now, during the elections, the Election Commission is in charge of what happens effectively. We've had various cases where the Supreme Court has also decided that this is actually in the purview of the Election Commission. Let the Election Commission decide. What happens if, like Mr. Reddy is suggesting, that we take the Model Code of Conduct not so literally and not take it so seriously and actually have it subject a little bit to context and interpretation, and the Election Commission also takes a month to make a decision on everything, what happens to the quality of our democracy, Professor Choker?
Well, what happens to the quality of our democracy is what is happening right now. See, the point is, you know, there is a more fundamental issue here. The quality of our democracy cannot be improved unless we can make political parties take responsibility for their actions. And Election Commission, I must say, is constrained in doing that, because Election Commission, under a judgment of the Supreme Court, cannot deregister a political party. So we are finding solutions in the election commission, in the Supreme Court, in the voters, in the media, in AC rooms, in non-AC rooms. We are not, this is the elephant in the room. Yes. Political parties are the major player in the election process. They are above the law of the land. Yes. Unless they have to be made responsible for their actions, only then can the system be improved.
Well, I want to take the question now to Neerja Chaudhary. Ms. Chaudhary, I'm glad at least today you have an AC room, because I know you've put yourself through a lot in the last 1 month tracking this election. But the truth is, we have three more weeks of campaign and voting to go. We have three more phases. Do you expect, we've actually seen political discourse really deteriorate in the last, in the last 1 month. And like you said, there's name calling, there's a lot of very unsavory things that are being said that are making people uncomfortable, perhaps because it's being said for the first time in our country. Do you expect, as a political observer, for this to get worse in the next 3 weeks? Are we going to see or hear worse things being said by our politicians all around?
I don't know the answer to that. And you know, the fact that we are able to debate this, and I would agree that one is not looking for a debate that's sanitized. You know, the cacophony of Indian democracy is part of its charm. You know, so much different ways of speaking, different ways of criticizing, color and noise and the dust and all that makes up for Indian democracy. And that's also part of our pride. But I would say certain things should not be, very clearly, abusive against each other. I'm sure the model code of conduct covers that. Anything that sows discord between castes, communities, religions. And I would say that the area that's bothered people is, you know, any words that give the impression that the armed forces of India belong more to one party than to the nation. That is the thing that has bothered a lot of people.
That's very well said. In fact, we must note, and while I thank my panelists for giving us that time this evening, we must note that the Supreme Court is considering the matter. And every time the EC has reacted, including when it sent notices to Mayawati and Azam Khan and Yogi Adityanath of Uttar Pradesh and took them off the campaign trail for 48 and 72 hours, it did so after the Supreme Court asked why the EC was not taking any action. The Supreme Court is considering the matter again. And so we look towards the Election Commission one more time, because while there is an election on, the democracy is in your custody. While the democracy is in your custody, dear Election Commissioner, we expect you to take good care of it. Thanks for watching.